subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We have with us today Kerala Chief Secretary Dr. Vishwas Mehta, who will talk to us about the COVID situation in Kerala. Welcome, sir. Thank you for speaking to us. So Kerala was the it was like the poster boy of COVID management in India, and now you are getting, I think, about five. Yesterday you had about 5,000 cases. So we just visited a COVID first line care center that has been made into a second line center because there were so many cases. So what happened here, sir?
The first case from Wuhan came to Kerala in India. That was on 30th January. Government of India had no clue. Health officials, health experts had no clue about COVID-19. They had no idea what protocols to follow. We also didn't know much because it had just spread to Wuhan, and suddenly it came as a big surprise to us. So the simple thing which we did is what Kerala had done about 2 years ago in Nipah virus. COVID is also an influenza virus, so we followed those protocols. The difference between Nipah and COVID is that Nipah virus's fatality is very high. If it multiplies, a lot of people will die. COVID, as we know, fatality is about 2%. Our national average is about 1.2%, I think. Kerala is 0.3%.
National average is 1.5.
National average is 1.5. So we will not say that we have done badly. When the virus runs through the community, there is little you can do about it, except that our bodies have to fight it out. 30th January till 4th of May, if you look at the records of what we did, the quarantine policies, the protocols we followed, the surveillance which we did, we had the best recovery rate in the world. That's why Kerala got noticed. We had 98% case recoveries. As on 4th May, we had only 14 cases left, 14 active cases left. And only 2 deaths were there. That means basically, despite January, February, March, April, May, 5 months, we had been able to control the virus. This is the time when the lockdown had happened. That lockdown helped us in preparing ourselves better in terms of equipments, in terms of PPE kits, in terms of machines, in terms of setting up extra facilities. I think it helped everywhere else, just like Kerala was benefiting. But I think the biggest advantage we had was that we have a very, very robust health infrastructure, where Kerala is 15 to 20 years ahead of other places. I know it because I was health secretary here for 4 years. I also know it because I was also in the health ministry as joint secretary, where I knew what was happening in other states. What happened after 4th May? The borders were opened, lockdown was lifted, flights started later on. We had 33 lakhs non-resident Keralites living in foreign countries. 22 lakh of them were living in Gulf countries. They wanted to come back because disease had spread there. Many of them were dying, many of them were infected. Kerala, because it was safe haven, people wanted to come back. Not only from Gulf countries, but people of Kerala origin living and settled in other states, especially Mumbai, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. They started coming here thinking Kerala is safe because they have controlled it. Now, we had no choice. We had to open the borders. We can't say no to our own people. It's not only about Kerala, it's about people traveling. But we wanted protocols to be followed. We said if you open the flights, let it be controlled flights. Let the protocols be followed. Why not we test them? Why not we ensure that people with negative certificate only come? But they started Bharat, that Swabhiman Bharat or Swabhiman. Yeah, that campaign started. There's nothing we could do. There was a lot of pressure on us also to allow them. Train started. So we had to open our borders. Everywhere we had to deploy checkposts, health officials, to screen people. You will be surprised, till June or July, we had almost 95% imported cases from Gulf as well as from other states. Thousands of people coming inside by road, by train, by flights. And we were constantly monitoring them. We had our own portal called COVID Jagrata portal, which we were registering. And we were, every day we were monitoring only one thing: how many are imported cases, how many are contact cases. As long as contact is less, we are in control. One very important protocol which we followed, which perhaps is the strength of Kerala, is that we activated very early, in February itself, ward level committees. I'm not talking about panchayat level committees, we went beyond that. We have a very robust local body representatives available to us, different political affiliations, but very, very active. We entrusted the whole thing to them. We formed them as committees of local elected bodies, attached health volunteers with them, attached police with them, attached whole lot of local self-help groups, and gave them this task, trained them how to follow the quarantine, what protocols to follow, how do you surveillance, how do you ensure what is primary and what is secondary contact, how when a person is positive has to be handled. So ward level committees were actually doing a fantastic job, and primarily because there is a high level of literacy and awareness here. There is a health seeking behavior in Kerala. But very soon what happened is the contacts number started increasing from 5% to 10, 10 became 20, and finally a stage came somewhere in August where we had to admit that community spread has happened, because people are still coming from abroad. But those reported cases were more spreading through contacts. That means community spread has happened. When community spread happens, what do? Can you deploy a policeman or a health volunteer with individual? No. Then you have to take care, look after yourself. You have to look after your own body.
Mitigation.
You have to ensure that you don't spread it to anybody else. That means you have to practice what you are preaching to others. So that actually, after some time, people got fed up. Lockdown was lifted. People thought we have to live with this. So that is the reason. I'll show you a classic chart. This is till 4th May.
Hmm.
You see the graph crossing here?
Yeah.
The number of recoveries were much higher than the number of COVID cases. And deaths are only two.
Right.
Now look at the projections. Our recovery rate is still high. We are doing these projections now.
Hmm.
As on 9th October, we predicted 17,000 cases per day. This is what we predicted based on R naught factor, as we call it. One person gives it to how many people?
Yeah.
So we are constantly watching this. Now, fortunately, Kerala, it's not gone the way.
But you're still below this.
We are still below this. It's up to 5,000.
What's your R value now?
What is our R value? It varies from state to district to district.
Okay.
It can't be constant for the whole Kerala.
Okay.
So then we do this kind of analysis, you know, weekly. How many cases last week? How does it appear? How does it look every district? What is the doubling time? Weekly we take.
Mm-hmm.
This being watched every day.
So now, what's your bed occupancy status?
We have, you have seen the COVID first line centers. We have developed a system by which we, every district will have two or three COVID hospitals. Now basically what has happened in foreign countries is that the hospital system collapses. Everybody rushes to the hospital. Everybody doesn't need ICU beds, doesn't need ventilator care. And you have to protect the hospitals from collapsing. If the it's actually, we must understand about COVID is it's not as deadly it is made out to be. It is deadly only for those people who have comorbidities, who are hypertension, who have diabetes, who are above 60, who have respiratory problems, who have low immunities. It's only fatal for them. Common man will come and go. So not for complacency, but the point is that it's the numbers which are scary.
Yeah.
When 5,000 becomes 10,000, 10,000 becomes 20,000, 1% of this becomes a problem for us. So disease as such is not scary. It's the numbers which are scary, which can actually throw your system topsy-turvy. This is what we have been preparing for a long time. What I had started doing is about 3 months ago, before becoming chief secretary, I was home secretary, a state nodal officer. I had started identifying all the facilities in government and private which are possibly available to us. The right from not only hospitals, but polyclinics, single bed hospitals, schools, colleges, hospitals, everything. Everything we started identifying. We even identified auditoriums, the marriage halls. And Kerala has enough of them, let me tell you. Because traditionally we have been using it for flood or disaster relief. So we at quick short notice, we are able to convert them. So the idea of first line COVID centers came like this. Any person with mild symptoms, not serious, first goes there. After 1 week or so, if he recovers, you know, he goes to the home isolation, quarantine. If it is serious, he is rushed to a COVID hospital. Now, suppose that number gets filled up. You have the beds filling up quickly in four. Then you have second line available there. So we don't allow the beds to be. You said about filling up beds. It's not, it's dynamic figure. The moment it reaches a critical number, we take the patients to the second line. Third level, fourth level.
Right.
So we have those things ready, available. We have stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4 kind of CFLTC which are ready. The problem is not about numbers or beds. Problem is about human resources, about health resources.
Right.
You know, the doctors, the nurses, the health workers. That is where the problem lies.
You've just had a strike called off, health workers strike. What are the issues there? Are they overworked? What are their demands?
They are getting tired, and they feel that with the numbers spiraling up, they are not being given enough attention. Maybe in the field, what is happening? There are a lot of contractual employees. Now, when we were facing financial problems, all our salaries were cut. So instead of giving them higher pay to work, we had to cut down salaries. I don't know if the doctors are affected or not. But if you give them full salaries and deprive others, there will be a problem. Because police also is working. A whole lot of volunteers are working without money. So everybody is tiring out. It's a game of patience. So these are, I won't take it seriously. I will say that these are resentments.
Right.
Or things which they are saying. Generally, our doctors, having worked here, are very, very responsible people, and they won't lead us to a crisis like this.
How much is the problem of infections among healthcare workers an issue?
It is there. They are getting infected just like anybody else. I don't see it a very serious thing. It is kind of scary for them because they are being exposed, you know, and to work with PPE kit all the time when the numbers are large is not easy.
Mm-hmm.
It's very uncomfortable to work in this.
Right.
You just see how many times can you wear mask and sit whole day, you know, it's difficult to talk. So unfortunately, police are infected, health volunteers are infected, health workers are getting infected. You see, we have to understand that virus will run through the community. There's no escape from it. We have to live with it. Most important for us is to save the fatalities.
You, as you keep saying, more you test, the more cases you will get. So give me an idea about your testing. How much RT-PCR and how much antigen testing are you doing currently?
I think RT-PCR must be about 15%. RT-PCR is the most confirmatory test. But the problem with RT-PCR is it takes time to get results. Antigen is fast. You get it on the same day. If you have to deal with large numbers, you have to have antigen tests. There could be false negatives, but it's okay. You see, if a person is tested positive, he will try to be cautious. That's the idea. He will exercise restraint. And in a literate society like Kerala, he will try to isolate himself. That's the idea. I think if you do 1 lakh test, you do 2 lakh test. If the community spread has happened, you will get more numbers. I don't think numbers are scary. We are really not worried about. We should know what is the extent of the problem. One particular problem which is of worrisome to me right now, hopefully it will be resolved, is the strain of virus which we have got. Through ICMR, when we try to find out, the infectivity is large. The infectivity is large, the strain of virus which has come. I have asked Government of India to find out. It need not necessarily mean fatality is large, but I think it's spreading faster than what we expected, or it is happening. And one of the perhaps indicators of this is that the test positivity rate is higher than the national average now. Out of 100 people you test, you have 13 people positive, whereas national average is 8. But then nation-wise, if you look at some states, I won't name, how many of this data is correct? Kerala it captures. You cannot hide the facts.
Is this a different strain from your first wave then?
No. First strain we never knew.
We don't know
because it was all imported cases. Okay. And nobody tried to find out. See, there are several strains of viruses which might be circulating. When I tried to find deep into this, I found these strains have perhaps come from the Maharashtra side.
Mm-hmm.
One or two select colonies where this strain had and it can get more virulent.
Mm-hmm.
It can change.
Right.
Its strain can also change. It need not be same what has come here.
Right.
So that is one thing. And second thing is we are not understanding the peak. You know, when is the peak likely to come and come down? It's coming like a plateau here.
Your projections are not showing when is the peak. Look,
projections show. I have done this projection how many times? I did it in March, I did it in May, April, May, June, July. And I remember that the National India media was celebrating.
Yeah.
And our people were saying, you have done a great job. I said, no. I remember talking to you, saying that, no, it's not over yet. There's nothing to celebrate. It's not over. And it happened. And I have been telling my chief minister, I have been telling everybody, it's not over. It will come back. So mentally, all of us were prepared.
Mm-hmm.
One great thing about Kerala, I must say, is that every day Chief Minister used to call a meeting of all the officers. And every day after meeting, he takes few decisions after listening to us. And those decisions are communicated every day in the press conference by him. How many states will do that?
Yeah.
Now, advantage of that is that these decisions taken by him are communicated directly to the people through the media. It's coming directly from the head of the government. And we have no choice but to issue orders.
Right.
Because it has been already communicated to people.
Right.
So, I mean, you have a leadership which is actually taking things from front. But then, what do? When it has spread, can we physically control it? Can we say, no, you must call now? Can we fudge the figures? We cannot. And we decided not to do it.
So you may, the state government was quoted as saying that Onam is one of the reasons why the laxity has happened. I believe there have been some protests also happening with people sloganeering and all that. Did that also contribute to the spike?
Of course it did. You know, elections are going to come next year. There are a lot of political activities going on. Sometimes people forget in the heat of movement that nobody is sacrosanct. Virus doesn't recognize which party you belong to. So when you are becoming a law and order issue, then it becomes these things, protocol gets compromised. So finally what Chief Minister did is that he called all the political parties. He said, with the numbers going up, can we keep it on the bench? And I'm glad most of the people agreed. If you say 20 people, 30 people, not more than that, people still 50 learn. And if there is some scuffle, some pushing around, I had officers, police officers who got positive. Right. I had MLAs who got positive. I had ministers who got positive. So there's no escape from this.
Right. So Trivandrum has about a quarter of all your deaths, COVID deaths. What is the issue here?
Actually, our problem started with the fishery, coastal areas. A lot of fish and fish-related trucks come from Tamil Nadu and other places. And we found out that they were the prime source. Now, people in coastal areas are very close communities. Conservative people who don't follow anyone. They are generally healthy, very good. But they live together. No matter what you say, they don't care. So initially they didn't take it seriously. When we told them that, you know, save your elderly, you might look healthy, but you don't know, even if 1 out of 100 falls sick, it can result into a problem. If you look at the analysis of death, which has happened, 859 have died till yesterday. I think 85% are those above 60. 98% are with comorbidities. If COVID was not there, some of these people with comorbidities would have died naturally.
Yeah.
Now, Kerala, we attribute to COVID. There are many states who say, should I show it as COVID or should I not show it as COVID? I know there are states who are doing it. But for us, it's simple. Because of the health traditions in Kerala and awareness, any unnatural, any death which happens, we follow the same protocol of taking a swab, giving the body back, and ask them to follow the COVID protocol.
Right.
The test result come after 2 days, then we declare them that this was positive or not negative. But before that, protocol has been followed and body has been disposed. But we don't hold on to the body.
So going forward, what from here, what will you do? You have 144, section 144 in place. What is your future plan for COVID? How are you going to go about it?
We have to live with this. We have to work around COVID. You cannot close down everything. People beyond the limit, you cannot.
Lockdown is not an option.
That's why 144 was thought of. And we left the powers to the collectors. Because they can, every day the situation is changing. They know the containment areas. They know the clusters. It's being monitored on a day-to-day basis by the collectors, by us. And district disaster management authorities are there. So they will be monitoring it and they will be doing it on a selective basis. Where what activity should be allowed, what should not be allowed. Idea is to contain the spread. Spread has already happened. If you go by Government of India guidelines, okay, cinemas open, multiplex open, swimming pool open, construction activities open, shops open. Well, we agree to that, but the point is, in how many shops can you have policemen watching that not more than 5 people will stand, how many of them will stand in queue, what kind of protocol or touching or mask are there. You must have seen the compliances, it's very good, everybody wears a mask here. So it's not possible. So our ward level committees have also tired out, local bodies elections are going to come. So finally we decided to mobilize at district level sectoral magistrates who will be in charge of the panchayats. Collectors will pick up any gazetted officer from any department, train them and say that you are in charge of that place, and you go around, you find somebody is not, just close it, that's all. So instead of closing the whole markets or whole shopping establishments, we just take action on this. If in a small town or a city, if 5 shops are closed, the message is loud and clear. If you don't follow protocol, you lose your business. But we can't do it all over Kerala. That is the difference.
That was Dr. Vishwas Mehta, Chief Secretary Kerala, speaking to the print. This is Obuntika Ghosh reporting from Trivandrum.